I, Philip Joseph here,
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
We came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body of
my
party.
We have to take pride on how we've handled
the illegal entry of persons coming in from Martinique, and Martinique remains an area of high risk for us because...
You see all the nice things, all the appealing things, all the emotional things to touch people's heart because you want them to support you and follow you, you inspire them, you give them hope.
But what about the culture of people getting to office and not being effective in terms of
portfolio?
No, but Carla, hold on.
Who handled his portfolio?
Hold on.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live.
I, Philip Joseph here,
I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
We came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body of
my
party.
We have to take pride on how we've handled
the illegal entry of persons coming in from Martinique, and Martinique remains an area of higher risk for us because...
You see all the nice things, all the appealing things, all the emotional things to touch people's heart because you want them to support you and follow you, you inspire them, you give them hope.
But what about the culture of people getting to office and not being effective in terms of
portfolio?
No, but Carla, hold on.
Who handled his portfolio?
Hold on.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live.
Very good evening to you. Welcome to another edition of Newsmaker Live right here on Media Television. With me, Timothy Foley, one of those special broadcasts. We go up until 10 o'clock this evening, and we start with a period with the clip and Pete Sandari as our special guest.
He is refrained. The last time he was on was just before the 2021 general election. Since then, we have not seen him on talk. We continue to him, though, on New Spin. People think that he's my co-host. I think he's my co-host, calling every day and definitely making a valuable contribution in the broadcast and in our famous chat room. A lot of people normally would be asking, where is Rick? We hope we
can hear from him today. So welcome to Newsmaker Live. I called you today, Rick, and you agreed to be on. Somebody saying the audio is very low, so my producer is hoping that you can address this as soon as possible. Somebody saying no sound now. Okay, but what's new? Go ahead, Rick. Welcome to Newsmaker Live, Rick. What have you been up to?
Look, I expect better treatment than the volume is low. My producer got to go.
Okay, somebody say okay, the audio is better, thanks.
Okay,
all right,
Tim, to be quite candid, I don't know how the hell you pull this off. For months now, people call me up, Rick, and they have to do the talk. We have your audience waiting. We have the, and I say to myself, okay, I'm going to call Junior and maybe I'll do it next week. And then I don't. I postpone. And you call me this evening without any warning. And I was thinking of that while I was having a hard time getting dressed, because of my bad back, I got to bend to tie my shoes and all that kind of thing. That is a performance, okay? And I'm asking myself, how did he pull that off? That you actually got me to get dressed and come out here.
I guess something otherworldly occurred.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, something like
Bolum,
something to
Bolum
that.
Stuff.
Yeah. But I'm happy that you agreed to be on.
I'm happy I did as well. It's usually, as it is, you know, you don't want to go out, but when you go, once you're out, you're out.
So. My first question to you is, when will you be back on talk?
I have no idea. This kind of makes me feel, you know, itchy to come back. But, Tim, I think what passes for shows today is so aberrational, you know, déclassé. There's no wit. It's like the journalism, four-line journalism. Guys who write four lines a week and go and talk get a recording from a dumb minister or whatever, and right away that's the news for the day. Mm-hmm. And everybody's reporting the same thing. There's no analysis of anything. There's no narrative that's different from anything you've heard before. Been there, done that. And I kind of feel I'm above that crap. You know, the years I've put in, I'm 150 now. Mm-hmm. You know, it's almost a joke. Whatever. That's what has held me back. But as you know, my interest in how St. Lucia is functioning, how St. Lucia is ticking, and I have a lot of the answers, Tim. Not that I'm so bright, but the answers are there to be read. All you have to do is go back in time, read Hansard, read the Star, the old volumes, or read what's online and what was happening today. Like James Baldwin said, you are history. Right now is history. You are how you've lived. So history is you right now. But St. Lucians seem, this is the subject they most, they try to avoid most anything historical. But of course, we're into this game. We have to know who we are as a people. And the way we do that is to start talking about the Middle Passage and how many slaves came out. That's how we know who we are. We don't want to talk about who we are from 1979, since we took control of our own destiny. We don't talk about that. So I kind of feel infradig is the phrase. Infradig, look it up. I feel kind of infradig, but I'm happy to be here with you. I'm happy to be here with you, and that might still be off the cuff.
How do you think we have done from independence to now in terms of our stewardship, in terms of taking care of our own business? Because I think by now, if England was still presiding over our external matters, okay, if we only were responsible for what occurred internally and Britain was taking care of us externally, we would be saying then we have no choice. The situation is as it is right now because we do not have total control over our country. We cannot rule, we cannot decide things and so on. But from 1979 up until now, we've been in charge.
I keep forgetting his name. The guy who has the Tesla car, what's his name?
Musk.
Huh?
Musk.
Musk. Brilliant. Mm-hmm. This guy is on. And I was watching him being interviewed by Rogan recently. And effectively what he was saying is, what's happening here might not even be real. And it's very deep.
Elon Musk.
Elon Musk. Mm-hmm. And he's talking about, we already are robots and we don't even realize it. Our cell phones are the extension that makes us robots. And the time is coming very, very soon when we will not be having the cell phone and all the chips and everything will be new. So that is how fast people will be thinking. We will not disappear. We will just change from what we know human beings to be. We'll be like walking computers. I think while you were saying that, I was thinking of St. Lucia, you know, because you were saying this might just be a simulation. And I sometimes think St. Lucia is a simulation. You know, whoever started the phrase St. Lucia is not a real place, mm-hmm. It's true. So now how do we start judging how have we done? How have we done in what? In what? If we were in another place, I would use a F word to say what we, you know, what we have done. What have we done in what? Are we less self-destructive in our day-to-day lives? We are more self-destructive than ever before. We don't know the meaning of a united effort. The only thing we can unite for is to hurt somebody else, or very often to hurt ourselves subconsciously. We don't even know we're hurting ourselves. Because you cannot, I've said many, many times, St. Lucia hates herself. Because you can't have half the country hating another half, and of course getting it in return. So the whole country is involved in hate. So it's a country that hates itself. A country that hates itself ain't going nowhere. A guy called Charles Darrow. Darrow made that point. You cannot get anything out of hate. Nothing constructive can come out of hate. And St. Lucia is full of hate. And that hate has been piling up. We want to say maybe it was the last elections. That hate has been there a long time. It came to a head in 1979 when in the Boulevard time, etc. It was a little lull. Then we got into all the shootings that led to ORC. All of that is tied up with how well we have done. We've done nothing
But you think that some politicians have benefited from that kind of divisiveness?
But it's the politicians' toolkit to get people to hate themselves. The politicians also hate one another, but they share one thing: greed and pretend power and all that kind of stuff. They share that. They have those things in common, but they also hate one another. They hate one another. You think the politicians are on any grade higher than the average citizen? To go out and spew hate, you must be a boiling cauldron of hate yourself, you know.
But why do you think we permit it? We allow it as evil.
We're not permitting anything. We are the devil's automatic auto control, remote control. We're not controlling anything. What we are seeing here comes naturally. It comes naturally to say something nice about Timothy Pollyon. It's so natural to say something awful. When I first came here, I noticed that the newspapers never wrote any what I call positive pieces, personality. I give an instance of that. I had written my book, which is by now a classic, It'll Be Right in the Morning. Got fantastic reviews in Canada, New York, etc. So I wasn't living here, but I came out here and I gave George a copy of the book. And George Odlum was part of the book, and I said, read it and do a review. Mm-hmm. Now, I expected that George might have given me a bad review or disagreed with things I said in the book, but you know what he did? He just reproduced a review from a Canadian newspaper. Later on, as we went along, I got to know him better. I asked him, why is it you don't write anything uplifting about people, because just with the politics. I wrote a lot of politics. I burned a lot of politicians, and I also wrote great articles about a lot of people in this country. There are people in this country, others will say, Rick Wayne made that person. Rick Wayne made that person. Look at the articles I wrote about Kenny Anthony back in the day when I promoted, and so on. I get as much pleasure writing well and about to writing good about somebody as I get the same pleasure exposing somebody's backside when they need to be exposed. And always I try to do the same level of writing.
If the whole country is considered to be in a miasma right now, is there anything positive to write about? Is there anyone who stands out that warrants you giving them a good review, Rick?
You see, that's a great question. And it's interesting that my mind has not moved to even be considering that. But as we speak, I would say from the top of my head, a guy who deserves, and it's not setting out to write a nice puff piece and make a guy look good. It is writing a piece about a guy because I see some good things in him, mm-hmm. and I could write. And the guy, you know, I remember Arnold Schwarzenegger saying to me once that he was doing a course at UCLA on business administration. And they wanted him to do an essay on the guy he likes most, he most admires, and the guy he most despises. So I said, well, who's the guy you most admire? And we were driving at a particular outside, by that time we had gotten outside the Weeder building, it takes about two blocks. And so he went, he didn't speak, because there were other people in the car. I said, who's the guy you despise? And he went, no, who's the guy you like that you want to emulate? He pointed out to Weeder building, meaning Joe Weeder, because mm-hmm. Joe Weeder brought me.
Right.
And I said, who's the guy you despise? And he looked at me, the same person, the same Joe Weeder. Mm-hmm. Okay, there are things about Joe Weeder he despised, but that didn't mean he couldn't see the good things in Joe Weeder as well. Because most people are like that, and nobody's perfect. Nobody has wonderful things. And the guy I'm thinking of is Kenny Anthony. Does that blow your mind?
It does, because you've been very critical of Rick,
of course,
Kenny Anthony consistently.
Of course. But Kenny,
and there are people in the St. Lucia Labour Party, supporters of the St. Lucia Labour Party, who don't like you for that.
Yeah, that's mm-hmm. correct. Mm-hmm. I've written scathingly of Kenny Anthony, and I think up to now I wouldn't change a word. But that, don't let that, and especially with the times having moved, Kenny Anthony has some very good qualities. Very good qualities. There are situations where I call Kenny Anthony weak. Whereas he, and it's mainly because he doesn't want to hurt anybody. Right now, Kenny Anthony is going through a purgatory because Kenny Anthony doesn't want to speak. You realize Kenny Anthony did not speak on the...
Special prosecutor's bill?
Special prosecutor. Mm. Prosecutor.
Yeah.
Special prosecutor. He didn't speak on that. And Kenny Anthony would have had a lot to say about that. He's a constitutional expert. He's a lawyer. He had all the experience.
I don't think he spoke on the firearms amendment.
And he did not speak on the firearms either. Mm-hmm. You think that's accidental? No. He just didn't want to say anything to make the people look bad. And now those are the good things.
If you had to rank prime ministers, would he come at what? Top three?
Tim, I don't think there's any such thing as we've had a good prime minister, ever. No, good prime minister. Why do you have a good prime minister? What is a good prime minister?
Decent. A prime minister who dealt with the issues of the day in a very adept manner, who seemed to be very au fait, au courant with what was happening.
You don't go to school to be prime minister. And people get into politics here, and whatever skills they have, we don't even know what skills they have. And a few of them have some arcane degrees that have nothing to do with the job they do. The public servants are the ones who do what needs to be done in the country. The people we elect are a bunch of idiots. They have no plan, no idea, no nothing. And that is in degrees. Some are like Compton. Compton was a guy of ideas, and Compton was at a higher level. Maybe it was the times with all of Compton's carbuncles. You know, it's interesting. I say this to people. There was a time, perhaps even before the days of John Compton, where parents would look at the parliament, the House of Assembly, as a place to look for exemplar behavior. And although the guys who were there at that time secretly had their own perversions and whatever, but the image they projected, which was more important than what they did in the dark, the image they projected was inspiring. Mm-hmm. When Henry Girolli was on there, we don't care about what you say about him. He spoke perfect English. He was witty. He knew the law. He had ideas of his own. George Mallet, John Compton, Hunter Francois, all these guys. And George Odlum, even George Odlum. I know people talk about George Odlum's writing and his speeches. But you know, the way you can really see George Orwell's mind is in the Hansards, you know. That is where he delivered those great speeches, those very instructive speeches in the Hansard. That's where you go to look for it. So it's all there. So I don't know what prime minister was the best prime minister. The times, Compton had a great time, and he probably could have done with better advice, had better used the funds we're getting as grants and so on. Money was easy in Compton's time, and some might say he frittered it away. Okay.
Dr. Kenny Anthony, his period as prime minister.
Kenny Anthony, you see, we keep on saying about we inherit this and we inherit that. And that's how I want to answer the question. It's difficult to answer this question. St. Lucia has always been broke. I've said so always. St. Lucia has never sustained itself. We have bananas, so maybe things were a little better then. It still was not any kind of a gold country. No, never mind we fool ourselves and call it green gold. We were always a poor country. The fact that a handful of people were able to pay their bills or maybe buy a car or a truck and that kind of stuff didn't mean we were not a poor country. The pristine atmosphere we had, the environment, we screwed that up. And it started with Compton and Pigeon Point and whatever. When you ask yourself, what was the point in linking Pigeon Point to the mainland and the cost of it in terms of the environmental damage? And all that time, by the way, the trust was there. So those are the things that I think of when I talk about who would be a great prime minister. A great prime minister would be a guy who would realize that education, not only education in the school, but skills training, skills, giving people skills. The school curriculum had to have things to instill self-confidence. Today you have people saying the black man, I'm a little black man from the, and all this inferiority complex. Where have you ever seen any special effort made via the schools to inject in our young people any kind of self-confidence so they can grow up as confident people and pass it on?
But when people say, I don't think that they're playing on the emotions of other people who do not know better, particularly the politicians, when they are subtly playing the race card.
Say that again.
Okay. When, for example, a guy says, little black boy from Marsha, as Mr. Philip J.
Very Pierce sad. Says that, very that's, often, that's a very sad line, by the way.
And don't you think it is a case of him playing on the emotions of people who do not
know better? No, they believe that. I think... you know, I was telling somebody on the phone a while ago about the soft bigotry of low expectations. People don't expect much here, you know. You know, you think I'm ever going
to
say...
Okay, so then you wonder why politicians continue to fail the people, if the people do not expect much.
The politicians don't fail the people. The politicians don't promise things that that people really expect them to deliver. They know, in any case, that where they can get money from. They know. They know. I mean, I'm having a perverse laugh now about what this thing that's going on in Soufré. There's nothing changed in what's going on in Soufré now from the time, from last election and before that, and Kenny Anthony's time, we got in the thing in Soufré. It's always been exactly as it is, Tim. But you get, the Labour Party is very good at stirring up, and from... Every politician in this country has gotten into office the same way, by stepping, putting their knees on the neck of the most of the poorest and most deprived people of the country. Think about that. Every single politician in this country has purported to have the interests of the little man at heart. They care about the poor man. They care about the poor man as steps into office, promise them the world, and or.
But why do they get away with it all the time?
What's that?
Why do they get away with it all the time?
Ignorance. The people relate to that. I mean, it's like my what's becoming one of my favorite lines. One of Alan Shastny's big mistakes. He insisted on singing opera to a hip-hop audience.
What do you mean?
When Alan Chastney, and I always say that too, that Alan Chastney did not know the people of this country well enough for his aspirations, to succeed with his aspirations. So it would be very careless of him to go out there and say, it's not every dog that barks I listen to. Let barking dogs, whatever. And that they were able to turn that. You can't queer short share. My queer not bad, eh? Okay. Queer short share. Barking dogs, lying down with dogs and getting up with fleas. These are famous tropes by famous people.
Yeah, but the SLP did it as well to Guy Joseph when he said that he is Alan Chastney's poodle.
Exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. But I heard someone saying on a show that Alan Chastney, that was proof Alan Chastney doesn't know the culture of our people, because if he did, he would know about our culture in terms of how we feel about dogs. What is our culture in terms of dogs? Wickedness to dogs,
yes.
Stoning dogs, allowing dogs in the street, stray dogs spreading disease, pelting dogs over. That is our, we are horrible to animals. And any people who are horrible to animals are horrible to people as well.
You think things will change politically the next 5 years?
Nothing is about to change.
The next decade, the next 15, the next 20 years? In terms of our level of sophistication? In terms of not allowing politicians to use us, particularly on what they say, what they promise, and the fact that invariably they are so unrealistic.
Several times during talk, I would say, it's fascinating how a politician can have five loaves, five bread. What do you call the ones they make in the oven? Tipin or whatever. Mm-hmm. Come on, help me out there.
Yeah, the loaves. They were loaves.
What do you mean loaves? I want to use the Creole.
They're called local bread.
Local bread. Yeah. All right. That means you don't know the Creole.
Yeah.
The local bread. A guy have no butter in it. The politician holds out five loaves. and he can control half of St. Lucia with those five laws. Because the audience believes if it sticks its head deep enough in that butt, he'll be definitely going to get a loaf. So all of them think they'll be the guy to get a loaf because they're ready to stick their heads wherever, whatever they have to do to get that loaf, they'll do it. That's what, it's as simple as
so
that.
So then you think,
now, you ask me that I think St. Lucia, St. Lucia cannot change. And there's no politician has the gonads to say why St. Lucia is in trouble. St. Lucia is in trouble because it has, the people in control of St. Lucia over the years were lazy enough to allow St. Lucians to lower their standards lower and lower instead of getting people to rise up to standards. I remember when I first came back here, people like, oh, I won't call anyone in this case, talking about speaking proper standard English. They made it a colonial thing to be able to speak quote-unquote properly. It didn't matter. And I remember John Compton, who was being pressured at the time to do what the Labour Party says it's going to do now. It's going to spend money on for people to, in school, teaching them Creole. Mm-hmm. Compton said straight out, Creole is not in any danger of going away, he says. In any event, I don't have the money to spend on a language that is not the language of economics and so on, so and so. So English is the language of business. English is the language of economics and whatever. So I want as many people as possible in St. Lucia to be able to speak impressively, to be able to write well, and so on and so on. What is happening now? We're pretending to try to eject a new love for our culture. Nice talk, but nothing is going on, you know, Tim. Nothing is going on when all this is going on, but learn to appreciate yourself and all that kind of stuff. They have already made the people feel insecure, made them inferior, and that is what's going on. We are on a whole spiral of getting worse and worse. The change will come if a politician has the gonads to tell the people, look, we have to stop there and return to the crossroads and see where we went wrong. That will call for self-sacrifice, Tim. It's going to call for a whole bunch of things that nobody is ready for, and nobody will get elected if he talks like that.
Now, in terms of serving as a countervailing force, do you think that as much as the politicians are misleading the people, that you need a more active and vibrant civil society, as obtains in many countries around the world, the US, in the region, Barbados, Jamaica, Trinidad, etc., to really open the eyes of the masses, because the politicians will not do it?
George Odlum did it, eh? George Odlum with the forum and whatnot, people, and you had people like Calix George at the time, you had Peter Josie, you had Hilford de Tourville, you had Julian Hunt, Hilary Modest, and all those, I remember all these people, Leo Clark, all these guys, Irvin Reed, all these guys were interested in literature, they were interested in writing well, they were interested in talking well, etc., etc. Nobody gives a damn anymore. Look at Parliament. I think I started telling you there was a time when you looked at Parliament and you wanted your kid secretly, you wanted your kid to grow up like that. If you're smart now as a parent, you make certain your kid does not.
Is there one or two MPs who stand out from the 17 who are in Parliament?
Not really, because they have to respond. They have to respond in kind. You know, they have to respond in kind. Like, you always tease me about Philip Pierre being my friend. Philip Pierre, I think, inside, is a good guy. I've known him a long time. I know you're laughing. You're laughing. He's a good guy. I think he is interested.
I am not disagreeing with you when you say he's a good guy.
Upliftment of the poor. I really think he but you see, you cannot pretend you are a socialist party. Isn't that what the Labour Party calls itself? Mm-hmm. A socialist party. In a capitalist country, and you have no money. Doesn't that sound like a joke? The socialist countries have money, you know, Tim. The country works for the state. The state pays all medical bills. They have money. We have no money and never have had money.
I mean, I think my big problem with politicians generally is that they're just too hypocritical. I mean, when in opposition, the kind of things they say when they get into office.
I'm not buying that at all. I don't think politicians are fooling anybody. I think politics has become an industry now for even for the voters. The voters sell their vote. They sell their vote. And there was a time we heard whispers of that. Today, politicians openly admit on both sides, mm-hmm. you know, that they bought votes, they banned, they buy votes. That's where we are. And so that's what the people have become. I told you on your show the other day, they are more, I was surprised you didn't pick me up on that to put me on the spot. I'm sorry you didn't. That there are more bad people here today than good. And I'm going to elaborate. The church, I'm not a believer in church and whatever, but the church played a great role. Because we have people who are supposed to be believers here and whatnot, and the church frightened you. If you did so and so, you go to hell, and all the lessons. The church lessons were fine, you know, no matter how hypocritical the preachers were. The lessons from the church were fine, and they developed a nice, good society. People figured if I do this and do that, I'm going to go to hell. Well, if the thought of going to hell prevents you from killing a child or raping a little girl and so on and so on, then wonderful. But now people don't go to church. The priests are, I don't even know how many priests we have here anymore. Priests are as vulnerable as their flock. You know, there's not an institution in the country that can stand up and say they're proud to be that institution and look at the work we are doing.
And I'll play that clip in just a moment where you said, you asked the question on your spin, which institution really stands out in St. Lucia? That we'll do that in just a moment. But we're due to take a break. The broadcast will continue in just a moment. Once again, you are watching Newsmaker Live right here on DBS Television. My guest is publisher of the Star newspaper. I don't know if he's still a talk
online.
Show host. I don't know if he's still a talk show host.
Yeah,
and that is
Rick Quinn. You must ask Junior.
Please stay with us. Back in just a moment. live on DBS Television, and we are also on Facebook. Somebody says they're half an hour into the show and people still commenting on Rick's looks. Rick, you have really impressed the ladies tonight. And I'll be going through some of the comments in the chat room in just a moment. Let's return to Philippe Jean-Pierre as he's the prime minister of this country.
Yeah.
Were you surprised that the Sinhalese Labour Party won and now we're talking about Prime Minister Philippe Jean-Pierre?
Say that again.
Okay. Number one, were you surprised that the Sinhalese Labour Party won? And to the extent today we can say Prime Minister Philippe Jean-Pierre. You ever imagine writing this in your Star newspaper online?
Yeah.
You envisage it happening at some point in
the day. Well, I mean, he would be the leader of the party. Mm-hmm. And the Labour Party had always had a good chance of winning an election, especially this one. And that's a question nobody asked.
Because there's always leader versus leader.
Nobody has asked
leader.
That question yet, why I thought the Labour Party lost.
The UDP. By the UDP lost.
Mm.
Yeah. Because there's always been leader versus leader. I mean, in the period of Sir John Compton and Julian Hunt. No. That's my perception.
Yeah.
In the period
you're right.
The period of Julian Hunt versus John Compton,
people always
saw it as John Compton winning.
Every election has been leader against leader.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And the same happened this time around. But a lot of people I spoke to never saw Philippe Jean-Pierre beating
Alan Chartier. I don't think it was leader against leader this time at all.
It wasn't?
No.
Okay. All right. But in terms of his performance,
performance
of
what?
No. Just give me your general opinion about his performance over the last
Jim,
year.
There is nothing for any prime minister to perform except some kind of joke pantomime. They all do the same thing. They're going to build roads. I mean, Alan was on roads. He built he did so much road stuff. The Labour Party started talking, look, man, we don't eat roads. Now the Labour Party is strictly on roads. The thing in Soufriere was horrible, and our patrimony, blah, blah, blah. We're back now. Nothing changes. It's just the sides change, and the loudest guys make the most noise. The United Workers Party lost because it never campaigned. Bottom line, the United Workers Party did not campaign.
Okay, but about your good friend Philippe Jean-Pierre again. He said on Newsmaker Live, I think it was in 2019, that he was the most readied. Is he displaying that capability? Most readied? And I'll play the clip. I'll give you sufficient time to think, and I'll just play the clip where he made that comment on Newsmaker Live.
I think you're getting a kick out of my
in 2019.
What people become Prime Minister of St. Lucia have been the most readied of all of them.
So again, you were ready now, then you were ready than yes. Dr. Anthony, even then.
Ready.
And then Alan Chastney, and Von Lewis, and
John Compton and George Charlton have been the most readied.
Because of what? Your years in politics?
Because my experience, my ministerial experience, based on ministerial experience. I've been the most readied. What people become Prime Minister of St. Lucia, I've been the most readied of all of them.
So again, you were ready now, then you were ready than yes. Dr. Anthony, even then.
Readied.
And Alan Chastney, and Von Lewis, and
John Compton, and George Charlton, I've been the most readied.
Because of what? Your years in politics?
Because my experience, my ministerial experience, based on ministerial experience, I've been the most ready. That's what I said. Based on ministerial experience. I'm doing nothing else. I'm saying nothing else. I'm just about ministerial experience. I've been the most ready.
But you could be in a job for an extended period.
I'm not
have
there.
The experience.
You asked me a question. Answer.
And then you're not ready for the job.
No.
You're not ready for a higher
said,
for elevation.
I've been the most ready. That's what I said.
Then when all those individuals.
All those before me.
You didn't mention Sir John.
I've been most ready than him. I've 15 years. He didn't have 15 years when he gave me. I've been the most readied.
Most readied.
I don't know there's any such word in the
No, forget that. Forget that. But we know what he said.
No. I'm saying I don't know there's any such word. Let me start there. Mm-hmm. There's such word. But then he went on to say, I am the most experienced politician. I'm the most experienced minister.
Mm-hmm.
And that prepares me more than any of my predecessors were prepared for the job of prime minister. It's a stupid statement. because you know that's nonsensical, because it turns back on you now. Because you know, like I keep saying, you know, when people talk about the new government, it's a year. Most of the time, our parliamentarians just shift gears, you know, Tim. They know everything about the problems of the country, either when they're in opposition, as well as when they even when they're in opposition, another. So there's nothing new. The problems we have only grown for all kinds of reasons, including the incompetence of our leaders, including the laziness of our public service, including the fact we don't have money to really do anything properly. We build cars with three wheels and we run on the one rim because we don't have money for that is how we've run the country. The country has not really changed, Tim, in terms of its assets, it's being able to sustain itself. We have always been existing thanks to the kindness of strangers. So what we're talking about is degrees of catching and whatnot. We're poor. We are poor in terms of money. We're poor in terms of the ability to unite and fight together. We are resilient people. We're not a resilient people. We are people who take whatever comes our way. And when you can't stop hurricanes, we have to go and hide under a rock when a hurricane comes. You call yourself resilient for that? You're not resilient. You run away from the hurricane. That's the natural thing to do. You catch your tail and you survive it. That doesn't make you resilient. What is it we... Unless, of course, living in St. Lucia demands that you be resilient, generally. But you hear all those phrases, but the bottom line thing, look at your police force. Your police force has been a ragtag thing forever. It's just degrees of ragtag. You have a situation here right now where I understand that the commissioner of police is about to retire.
In December?
Now, the guys unless the prime minister is thinking of bringing somebody from outside, which is going to be problematic, and he better not be white. You know, it's going to be problematic. I don't believe St. Lucians are now so into this insularity and so we have become so racist. We don't want to admit that. We have become more racist than ever. We always were, because I know the time when people like to say, you know, the time in the banks, mm-hmm, when the mm-hmm. people were light skinned and whatever, and they blame that on the people who are hiring them. But boy, the country didn't want to tolerate that. And the country went along with that, you know. People didn't want their daughters to marry a guy who's that black guy. And we have always...
Or Indians
or whatever. Yeah. We're doing it worse now because it is encouraged from the highest offices. You know, it's encouraged. But we really haven't, and we don't like to admit those things. If you don't admit where you screwed up, you're never going to do anything to fix it.
But think, for example, in the run-up to the last election, the behavior of some politicians in terms of playing the race card. Why do you think almost no one really spoke out against
because
this?
Because, great question. No one, I prefer to go out, the United Workers' Party, Alan Shastley's soldiers, none took it up. You know why? The insecurity. He'd be a suicide. You know, kissing white man ass in their own constituency. Their constituents, they can't tell the constituents anything and another white man and that man. They won't do that. That's too much work, and they run the risk of looking like they're kissing white butt. So nobody wants to, like, it's like suicide. Nobody wants to be called a suicide like Bula. You know, those things we don't want to be called here. So Bula, a suicide, kissing white man, but that's what controls our minds. So even Alan said, I tell you, he had no campaign, because the most effective blows that were thrown at him, his men did not have the balls to stand up and say this is wrong, not just for Alan Shastley, but for the country. I didn't talk. I said it was laughable that St. Lucians were getting themselves involved in risk card politics.
But where was the church? Where was your National Youth Council?
They're all dead.
Where was your private sector?
Yeah, but they died. The church and so on died from the time of Compton and, you know, the his certain scandal. I don't want to call names right now, but I'm sure everybody knows the particular scandal. I don't want to, because the church, the members of the church were supporting Compton and that, you know. When that story came out, Compton got the highest mandate ever, you know. So it was okay for our prime minister to mess around with children. That was okay with St. Lucia establishment. Now, those are the things St. Lucians don't want to hear. But it's true. St. Lucians endorsed a prime minister having an affair with an underage girl, misrepresenting himself at embassies, and doing all those things. St. Lucian, I give a man a second chance. This is the country of most second chances if you want the right team. Mm-hmm. There are things that you have to take a stand on. Ain't no second chance. You do things that require you to go to jail, you go to jail. You know, you rape people, you don't have any... And you know, there's another thing too. Well, the man ain't got convicted, they ain't going to convict, no. Any candidate, any party worth its while, will not have as a candidate for elections or be associated with a person who has been seriously involved with rape. Just as it's intolerable that any party should have a guy with a reputation for drug trafficking in his party. Well, if we are going to make that norm and giving a second chance, then screw it. The whole country is going to fall in line with that. So that's what we have. So we ain't going nowhere. We're in deep reverse, down a casco. We're in deep reverse. And those are things nobody wants to talk about. Because I'm not going to say that, especially if on your side, you know. Like when you ballers got into trouble, call your show. Mm-hmm. All those people were calling your show. And I called you and I said, you know, Tim, I have a towel soaking in my toilet for occasions like this. So I can slap it in the face of all these do-gooders who are calling you and say, the man's supposed to resign, the man's supposed to be misconduct and everything else. But to this day, with all the scandals we've had of prime ministers and ministers, there is still not a code in place regarding the behavior, ministerial behavior or whatever, so that they walk. They don't even have to have it. They did so and said they got caught. They know they have to go.
But the prime minister is
up
working
to now, on, we don't have it.
Prime minister is working now on what? A special prosecutor to fight corruption? Isn't that worthy of showering praise on him for it?
Isn't you notice Kenny Anthony didn't talk about that?
Yeah.
Now, what is ironic is that in 1997, and I was part of that campaign, very much so, the campaign was transparency and accountability and corruption and whatever. I mean, we promised the people that we're going to get to the bottom of it. And of course, everything was said about Compton and everything about Lewis and whatever. And we had the egregious situation of George Mallet being handed a throne speech that was an indictment of his own government, all that kind of stuff. Quite vindictive. But at the time, I thought it was funny. So I'm one of those who should get slapped as well. I thought it was funny at the time. But I grew to realize that was horribly vindictive, because there should have been some respect for the Governor General and not give him that thing to read at a government in which he had been a Deputy Prime Minister for 40 years, to have him reading that his government was corrupt and they were going to have a thing. He read that. On reflection, I think that was one of the worst things that ever happened in St. Lucia. This was palpable vindictiveness. Interestingly, no matter how hard I tried to get to Famalet why he didn't resign on the spot or why he actually read it and whatnot, Mallet wouldn't say anything. He wouldn't talk about it. That's the kind of guy he was. But we've been planting those dragon's teeth, Tim, for a very, very long time, and we're reaping it now.
The number one issue for me right now is the worsening crime problem that we are experiencing in St. Lucia. I put it at number one, even before the high cost of living and inflation and the high cost of fuel and things of that nature. Let's play a clip of the mother of the latest homicide victim in St. Lucia, because this incident occurred in Deriso last evening, the fatal shooting of a 26-year-old male, the reaction of the mom today, and she spoke to DBS's Jason Darius. What we've just done out of that report, we just assembled the clips of the mother reacting to the murder of her son.
I didn't see anything. The only thing I heard was I was up sleeping, and I heard 5 gunshots. It somewhere in the yard, but it didn't sound like it was in the yard. I thought it was down the road. And then my sister's husband came out and said, dear, look, they kill your son in the yard there. When I came outside, I met my son on the ground, bleeding. But I didn't see anybody. I didn't hear anything. I didn't see any vehicle. I only saw my son on the ground. That's why I do not know anything much. I cannot say anything much. Well, everybody's heartbroken because that is a shock for everybody, because Cash was a loving person to everyone. In spite of his hard-headed, when you'd ask him to go and do something for you, he'd always say just now, but at the end of the day, he would still go and do it. You know, wherever you see he go out, he always bringing me a mango or a coconut, because he know I like this stuff. And he'd always hug me and say, mommy, you know I love you, right? And I tell him, I know, but I just need you to behave yourself and stay away from these people. You know, you have too many friends. You need to stay away. Why you cannot be like me? I do not have much friends. The few I have, I choose my friends properly, you know. It is time for them to stop. It is time for them to stop. They don't have to resolve to gunshot. Everything is a gunshot. There are different ways that they can deal with certain situation if there is a problem. It don't have to be a gunshot.
Inching Sue, the crime problem is in Nisha.
Jim, let me, I'm not going to read anything. I'll read away after that. Hansard, 11th March, 1998. 1998, March 31st, 1988, November 1997, March 1998. I pull those out, and there is speech after speech, and some of them absolutely brilliant, and some of them exposes the stupidity of our leaders. In particular, the I come back to that. The parole law, the bill, whatever. You know when that was passed? It was passed in 1997. And ironically, if you were to read that, you will see right there the problems we have in this country has always had to do with leadership. It came to the Senate, and you should hear the kind of stuff people were saying about being hard on the criminals and this and that and that. Maybe treat them like animals. Mm-hmm. And that is the general thing in the street anyway.
Yeah.
And of all people, Marius Wilson gave a brilliant assessment of the whole law itself, how it was passed primarily to ease up on the population of the prison that up across the bridge,
right,
to ease up on that. And the number of structures that needed to be in place for a program. You read this and you see ministers talking about how the parole, being on parole, would rehabilitate him. That's the cart before the horse. You have to be rehabilitated, appear before a board maybe once or twice, convince the board that you're ready to join as a decent citizen. Even that they had wrong. The irony of all of that is while Marius Wilson, I'm doing an article on it actually, so people can see, while Marius Wilson was absolutely on the ball in everything he said about this this parole thing, you know where Marius Wilson is right now.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, and Marius Wilson had showed signs that he needed therapy, he needed, but this society, if you are of a certain caliber, you know, everybody covers up for you. There were instances where Marius was supposed to appear in court. Magistrates were telling the witnesses, don't show up. I know about that. One was his girlfriend or his wife, whatever, he had done things. They talked her into dropping the cases, and eventually, all to do with guns, he ended up where he is. I understand he's now being a lawyer to the people, but we can't lose people like Marius Wilson. Same as those young people. Well, while I was watching, I said, what a good-looking young man. Mm-hmm. What a good-looking young man. And his mother lets you know it's all looks. And you follow the gang. Mm-hmm. And we never follow up. I said to you on your show, we never follow up to find out those guys, what in fact they did, what job did they have, tell people more about them, and we would perhaps come closer to finding out why those guys get in that kind of trouble. But the matter of this guy, and you know, by the way, there'll be no resolution to that. You would be shocked if there's a resolution.
In terms of an arrest?
A resolution, because arrest today and let him go tomorrow anyway. Okay? A policeman.
Based on what I'm hearing, it is possible that somebody can be arrested and convicted. Based on what I'm hearing.
Well, yeah. We hear that. Mm. A policeman. You hear anybody talking about the policeman who was killed moonlighting, the two policemen who were moonlighting and one
no.
was killed? You hear
no.
anybody talking about
no.
that? He's a policeman. Do we know anything from the other guy about what may have happened, what he knew? Do we know anything about that? Cover up. The policeman's wife who was killed at, do we talk about that?
Kimberly.
So, yeah, now let's go back to Giselle Georges. Years ago. Let's go back to Valinda Joseph. Unresolved. Unresolved. So we've been having homicides unresolved. Is the norm in this country, and we live with it. And now, Tim, I warned you about that on your show, that the outrage will disappear. It is totally dissipated now. People accept that every day there's going to be a murder now.
Mm-hmm.
They don't even talk to you about it on your show anymore.
They don't.
They talk about other subjects. So that is where we've got. So when you tell me what a prime minister is, a good prime minister, it began in Compton's time. It has happened under every prime minister. They've had no ideas what to do about it. In fact, Kenny Anthony did a speech in May, last May, and he admitted that every government had done its bit trying to at least ameliorate crime. And he said crime is overwhelming now, which is proof that the things we have been doing, his words, were wrong. And we've got to find other ways of trying to cope with crime. But there are a lot of other ways to cope with crime, but they don't go there. People like Dio Soran, the World Bank, yeah. These people have done research on the subject. What causes young people to do this and that? What causes the rage? And by the way, a lot of it has to do with politicians
mm-hmm.
and the governments not taking care of young people. A lot of it. So at the core of the blame are the politicians. And today we have politicians with their own reputation shakes you up. You scare them. So if we're going to embrace that and pretend it's not happening, let's live in that pretend world. Meanwhile, all our sons and daughters getting killed, or imprisoned, etc. I understand.
Before we continue, we'll put the telephone number on screen right now so that you can call with your questions and your comments for my guest, Rick Wynn, of the Star Newspaper Online, and very soon he'll be back on talk. Continue.
I mean, the prison director,
mm-hmm. Hilary Human.
Yeah, he's about to leave. The commissioner of police. So, who are the people that it's a small society that we know might do a better job? We don't. So, hopefully, they're going to get a guy, but one guy cannot change the police force. You gotta have a quality of police officers who love their work, who are well paid, who have insurance, and all. The government has to spend some money, and I've been saying so for years, to make the police force something that young people want to join. And we've also, just as we cannot be talking agriculture in terms of fork in the ground and whatever, we can no longer be expecting police officers to solve crime. The people who solve crime in the real world are forensic experts, detectives, special detectives. The policemen, such as we have here, even they have special training to protect crime scenes. We're primitive. We're still primitive, and that primitiveness is being applauded. And I can imagine a lot of them out there saying, "Rick just running down people." Rick and Ronnie are no people. Rick is telling us we're in deep trouble. And mainly because we have tacitly endorsed this mediocrity.
Okay, so we are waiting your calls. We have the telephone number on screen, so you're going to call with your questions and comments. Let me see what is happening in the chat room, it's also been discovered that the loss of dignity is the main cause of conflict.
Loss of what?
The loss of dignity is the main cause of conflict. Does the Senushan youth feel that their dignity is intact? You want to take this one?
What is about it?
The dignity of the young people. Do you think that it is intact? Because the loss of dignity is what is the main cause of conflict.
I think this is a bit convoluted for me. What you have a lot now is the respect.
You don't respect
the boss. You know, a long time ago, Tim, when I was writing articles covering the court cases and crime and so on and so on, a number of the leading guys in the gangs and whatever would all tell me the same thing. Say, Ricky, we're in drugs. Yeah, it's true. But most of those shootings and whatnot have nothing to do with drugs, you know. It's lack of conflict resolution skills. And he gave me examples of a girlfriend coming from Anslery and going to Rodney Bay, and some guy picks her up. That guy gets killed because he disrespected the girl's boyfriend.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You realize Valinda Joseph's unresolved. Giselle Joseph's unresolved.
Kimberly DeLeon.
Kimberly is unresolved. And you know, imagine when these people get killed, we think just of their husband or their wife or their children. These people have family, they have relatives. And those of us who think we are beyond that, we are wrong. Our mouths are shut tight. We are wrong. It's not just the politicians letting down the people. The higher echelon, so-called, because they probably, when you analyze it, they're worse than the worst. They're only in a better place economically, but effectively, they're worse frogs than the poor people, because they can do something and they shut their mouths because they want to kiss butt to a particular politician or a particular government. Somebody was telling me the other day that I made the point that why is it we never thought about having prefab hospital custom built for the weather in St. Lucia? Because the Chinese, how many did they have in 6 weeks, 27 or something?
Yeah,
something like that.
At the time of COVID.
And the mm-hmm. price would be insignificant compared to the money we have spent, so. It does not occur to them. We could have had two since the fire. We could have had two prefab hospitals. Prefab, because hotels are prefab now, you know, Tim.
Yeah.
Etc. You know what one guy who in the know said to me? He said to me that when the governments call experts to come and discuss, it is a given that the expert knows what the government wants. So they go through the thing of pretending, you know, but they only go there to rubber stamp what they know the government does, because otherwise they don't get the job and they will not get work. There's this thing of consultation that I call the illusion of inclusion. It's all an illusion. There's no consultation. The government has determined what it wants and for what reasons and who going to get what from what. So they call the right engineers and all those guys are going to come down and say exactly what the government wants.
You think that's what's happening with St. Jude right now? Mr. Producer, our phone is working. Just want to get a feedback from you on this.
Uh-huh. St. Jude, uh-huh. It's happening everything in the country. Of course it's happening in St. Jude. St. Jude, we could have had two hospitals by now. Prefab. Right after the fire, within 2 years of the fire, we could have had two prefab hospitals. Why didn't we do that? Why are we still not doing that? Why are we still even considering it?
Because what? The Prime Minister says that he has to look at certain things, for example.
I don't care what the Prime Minister says.
Of the finances.
The Prime Minister is saying not what he has to say. The Prime Minister is saying what comes to mind at the moment. They're all the same because they don't really have the competence. Philip Pierre is not an engineer. So he must depend on what somebody else tells him. Alan's not an engineer. He has to depend on whatever. And everybody's scratching everybody's back because putting the people's first means the party. And it isn't only those who say putting the people's first. Others also give the impression that they will put you first. They take care of you because they're not in this. Politicians go into politics to make money as a job. So they can get employed, guaranteed employment for 5 years at least. They don't go in there because they can do anything for anybody, Tim.
But why do you think the people, again, I'm going back to the people. Why
the people,
do you think I don't
the see people
this?
Have made an industry at every election time. They make a few bucks.
Call that point. We have a call. Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air.
Yes, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Yes, I'm calling in reference to the point that Rick made.
Mm-hmm. Concerning?
Concerning the prisoners at the prison. Mm-hmm. Those that they put on payroll.
Yeah, parole.
Yeah, parole. Yeah.
Yes, there's a particular guy who killed that policeman. He shot that policeman at Tiroche.
Call all three of those guys were killers. And their sentences were commuted to life imprisonment.
Right.
And they were let go primarily to make space.
that's exactly what I'm saying. So what kind of payroll board that they have?
It's there? A joke. And by the way, the bill was passed in 97. Not until 2019 did a group called, Canada something or other, train, they set up a program for them and train the board. But there are no support. I mean, when they announced that there had been the parole, you will remember the government said that they're not going to name the guy's names, mm-hmm. etc. But Tim, in the real world, you have to name those guys. You remember a guy.
But let the caller conclude, and then you've got.
Yeah.
Go ahead, caller.
Up in the United States, when they go to payroll any prisoner that they have that commit a crime, you know, when they're going to payroll them, the relative of that person, the deceased, usually be at the court. Mm-hmm. Why were these people's family never invited? You know,
I am told they were in Ocala. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I am told they were. But I thought you were going to say that the normal thing is the government announces, I mean, who the people are who are going on parole. And sometimes the community does not want to accept them depending on what crime they have committed. But we don't even, I wanted to make the example, caller, that some years ago, the prison was still by the bridge, mm-hmm. and overflowing and all the horrors that were going on there, Compton decided to free up some of the people. And one of the people he picked up, just to make space, within 2 weeks, he was working as a grass cutter for a nurse, and he killed her. Horrible killer. Then they hanged him.
Mm-hmm. My point is...
And caller, the point is that the nurse never knew she had hired a killer to cut her grass.
Yes, caller, go ahead.
Now, my point is, these guys could be out there right now committing crime.
We don't know them.
As contract killers.
That's right.
Okay, caller. Thank you.
That's a point I wanted to bring up, and Mario spoke about that. Mm-hmm. You know? There's no monitoring, nothing. These guys are out there. They've been up there for years. They have no skills. They have no money. What do you expect them to do?
Okay, so let's see what's happening in the chat room as we continue with your calls. Somebody says, Rick, remember, St. Lucia is not a real place. I think you said that earlier on. Really, I think it's the other way around. Police are the ones who are being monitored.
I don't know what that means.
Well, I guess in terms of abridging the rights of citizens being accused of using excessive force and things of that nature.
Yeah.
Okay. But I think we have all the systems in place. We have all the laws. I think it's enforcement and how we execute those various
systems.
Yeah,
but you make that sound so easily, Tim. Mm. Enforcement requires manpower. Enforcement requires people that are skilled. The regular policeman no longer is a criminal expert. It's forensics and look at this girl, young woman who died. They found her body decomposition already. Mm,
Tasha
something Polius.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, yeah.
How long was that? Maybe 6 weeks?
About that.
And what a disgrace that the family has a pretty good idea who it is that is there, but they cannot officially do anything because the police have not given them the official yes. That is it. Meanwhile, the samples from the girl are being analyzed somewhere, and the police have no idea when they will get those samples back. In a year that we're living in, Tim, It was that way in Compton's day. It's still the same thing today, Tim. And the citizenry is getting more and more used to that. More and more used to that, living with that. We're living like frogs.
And in the meantime, are we lost?
We're lost.
Do we call on the authorities? Do we call on the authorities to address this? Because if we do call in the authorities, invariably, as I normally do on your spin, make reference to the National Security Minister, who is also the Prime Minister, and people are offended by this. Why make reference to the Prime Minister? Why make reference to the National Security Minister? Why not call on the police?
Because
where should it start? It should start somewhere.
Because the truth is that Philip here is not a policeman. He has never trained as a policeman, etc., etc. In the real world, you have people with experience overseeing certain departments and so on. Not here.
All that point. Good evening. Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
I just heard Rick talk about something to do with samples not coming back in and so on.
Yes.
Tim, I remember that guy, Moshiri, was the commissioner for a short stint. I remember hearing this gentleman say about some samples being sent overseas, samples to do with Kimberly Delay.
That's correct.
Yeah.
All right. And up to now, there has been nothing. And he actually said that that would probably take, you know, a couple of weeks or whatever.
And you have an accommodating DPP as well that nobody sees.
And up to now, there's nothing from that case. Nothing.
Nothing.
You know, Tim, I just strongly believe that I think those in authority taking us, the populace, for a ride.
Caller, may I challenge that?
And
caller?
Yes, Rick?
May I challenge that? Those authorities ain't taking us for a ride. We're all on the ride. We are all on the ride.
But it's a big joke in this place, Tim.
Which is not a joke, because people are dying. People are dying. You remember that phrase?
Yeah.
It's not a joke. It's a sick joke, caller.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
Don't call it a joke, because you might end up believing it's a joke. It's not a joke.
Unlike you alluded to earlier, it's like when we sit around, we're just expecting. There's no big fuss about all of the crime that's going on in terms of speaking about it. Okay? We talk about it when it happens. You see this young boy that lost his life last night. There was another shooting. Basically, two shootings in the Derisoe.
But, caller,
we're going to speak about it today, tomorrow. Then caller, that's it. It's gone.
They're encouraged to do that as well. Eh? Caller, that lady there all tear up. And you hear she's saying, and always it's the same story. Bad company. Where do those people go to quietly report to somebody that they need help? Their son is this. There's no place to go.
No place to go.
And don't ever forget also that when you have four or five children and one is bringing in money, you don't want to know where he got it from, you know. If the worst suspicions, you're not going to ask him, you know. You're just praying and saying no Venus, that nobody will kill him. Because
and that's where we're going wrong, Rick. That's where we're going wrong. As parents, we don't, you know,
put caller, our feet down. Caller, you see those words? Happen.
But then what's there in the society to actually assist
them? That's right.
What is there to actually help?
Caller.
What's the help?
Caller, I used to have a criminal contact. And after every show where I talked about crime, he would call me up. And he said, great show. He would tell me, great show, Rick. But those English words that you're using there, they have different meaning in the ghetto. And he reminded me too that most of the policemen come from the ghetto. And after work, they go back to the ghetto. You see the problems? So it's friends. Some went that way, some went that way. And nobody is even trying to get to grips with it. There's no effort being made to get to grips.
Final comment from you, caller?
Well, I'm hoping that those in authority can take crime serious, Tim. Especially when I think about the like, for instance, the canine dogs. I heard a big hoorah going on about that, but I think that was a good way to go. It was helping in some way, somehow.
Caller.
So I hope they can, you know, put their feet down and take things a little bit more serious.
Okay, caller. Thank you so much. Very clearly, you have no hope.
It's not a question about I have hope. If I have any hope, it will be like the people of St. Lucia will realize that we have to come together sometimes.
Okay, we have a call. Good evening to you. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hello.
Good night.
Hi, good evening to you, caller. Turn down the volume of whatever device you're using to watch or listen to the program because of the feedback. Turn it down and then proceed with your contribution, caller.
I think I've just turned it down.
Go ahead, please.
Yes. This is something I've been thinking about for a while now, and I wanted to give it to Rick for a very long time. I think it's about 25 years or so.
What's that? About 25 years?
So, Mr. Rick,
he wants to give you something.
A few words to you, right?
Thank you.
And sorry to... Nobody really put Rick on the spot, really.
Nobody.
But I'm going to put Rick on the spot tonight.
Okay.
Rick Wayne, I'm going to read it to you because I actually wrote it down.
Go ahead, caller, go ahead.
Rick Wayne is one of the best brains St. Lucia will ever come across. But hey, there is something I said 25 years ago. If Rick knew that he was in that stature and had knowledge that he was able to live to be the age of 150 years, he would have been the greatest DEV the world would have ever come across.
The greatest what?
The greatest what, caller?
DEV. Don't worry about it.
The greatest DEV.
What's that, man?
Don't get me wrong.
What is DEV, man?
He would want great change and good change for his country.
Thank you very much for that, caller. Thank you very much for that, caller. But don't do any more of that. You know how I handle that.
I agree totally.
Thank you.
Somebody that I love.
Thank you very much, caller. Thank you very much. Right. Thank you. That's it. Can we move on?
Exactly.
I appreciate it. Thank you very much. Okay.
That's it, caller.
Rick would have the power to take over not only St. Lucia, but the entire Caribbean.
Well, thank you very much, caller. That's enough.
All right, caller. One night. Thank you.
Let me say something to you, too. Mm-hmm. There are two people that I wish we could corral and make proper use of them. I fight one of them all the time. But there are two people that I think the country needs to hear from in a proper forum and regularly. The first is a young woman with criminal record and all kind of, she knows everything. She's, her name is Betty
Jean.
That woman, that young woman is, worth listening to. She's the most genuine voice in this country. And I really wish, when I do come back on talk, I want that woman on my show. And the other guy, surprise, 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 is the guy I made Man of the Year, Christopher Hunt. Christopher Hunt may have his little madnesses, but Christopher Hunt is so on the ball. I talked to him. So on the ball. He reads. He thinks out of the box. And he doesn't give a damn how you feel about what he has said. We cannot afford to have people like that out there frustrated as well. We have to create platforms for these people to talk to kids in the schools, to talk about their experiences. And how many women you think can talk about themselves like that Betty girl? Mm-hmm. She's done everything. And she wants to tell. In America, people like that are given tours. They lecture at universities. Criminals, reform criminals. We don't want to do that here. And we have these two people that we are not using.
I hope we
can get a platform.
Good evening, Newsmaker Live. Thanks for holding on. You're on the air.
Hi, good evening, Tim.
Good evening to you, caller.
Good evening, Rick.
Hi.
For finally making an appearance on television.
I don't know how the man did that.
We've been waiting for you for 2 years now, Rick, with your show.
Okay.
And I'm looking forward to the return.
Thank you.
You look really great, by the way. I don't know your age, but...
102.
102. Okay, we'll accept that.
All right.
But, Rick, the reason you're not getting 20 calls is that there's not much to add, because when you talk, you give a comprehensive outlook of what St. Lucia, because this country is really a joke.
With it's not a joke, caller.
A sick joke, as you said, with a big anchor tied to it. Because when you look at St. Lucia, there is no control. There is nothing that works in St. Lucia, nothing that you could think of actually worked.
Nothing
worked. Just like you said a while ago, who is the DPP accountable to?
Do you know just before the elections, he announced that there were a number of cases, particular cases, that he was going to prosecute?
Yes.
You know, a whole year has passed and not a word.
Not a word.
Not a word, not a word. And all those other unresolved murders and what, he is, the police will tell you the DPP has this and that. We can never know that's true because we hear nothing from him. Nothing. And the government has him in place. Kenny Anthony said, call, I don't want to take it, cut you off, but I'm saying quickly. Kenny Anthony, again, I'm using Kenny Anthony. Mm-hmm. Kenny Anthony said in the debate on the Constitution that he would like some changes because he's no longer in favor of protected jobs.
Mm-hmm.
That you have a contract or whatever it is, or you screw up, fire you. I am 100% with that. Go ahead, call, I'm sorry about that.
Yeah, so I was saying, in terms of controls, like everybody seems to be a boss unto themselves and they're not accountable to anybody.
Nobody.
Then the people, I don't know if we have been brainwashed so badly over the years that people don't understand that these guys are employed by us. They've been paid by our taxpayers.
Because they are big, get it right. Don't fool yourself with those things. They are not employed by us. They don't think they're employed by us, but they know they can put their hands down. Like when the government says, we lost so much money on the VAT. You never had the goddamn money. It was never yours. It was going to be pulled out of somebody's pocket. And you're saying we lost that. So let's put the thing back in place so we can start pulling money from people's pockets who don't know where the next job is coming from.
Go ahead, caller.
And lastly, In what country, in what place in the world would a sitting prime minister and the Speaker of the House go sit in a courtroom when one of his ministers, his sitting ministers, is in court and then he comes out and is interviewed and he says he went in there to see that justice is served? I mean, isn't that the height of jokes and taking
people, yeah, but
right? Okay, caller, thank you so much.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
I'm not going to comment.
No. Because he's your friend.
Not because my friend, because it's so small in the scheme of things. We are people are really dying, literally. They're dying from this incompetence that is running this country. And not just this government. All the governments have been the same team.
We have a call. Good evening to you.
One degree or another.
Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, Tim and hi, Rick.
Good evening to you, caller.
Tim, first of all, I would love to see you get a WhatsApp for your overseas callers like myself.
Yeah, we'll do that at DBS. Don't worry, we'll do that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, secondly, Rick, you look fantastic. You look very sharp tonight. I love the pink and yellow jacket.
You love the beard?
Amazing.
Do you like the beard?
Better than 50-year-olds. Keep it up. Whatever you're doing, keep it up.
Whatever. Rick, maybe it's what I'm not doing, caller.
I have to Rick you over the course tonight, though.
It's all right. No problem.
Your judgment and your discernment is questionable tonight.
Yeah.
The three people you highlighted and you praised tonight, and I'm wondering, where's your judgment? First of all, Tim asked you about a prime minister, a great prime minister, and you mentioned Kenny Anthony. And I'm not taking away anything from Kenny Anthony, but the reasons you cited were because...
Wait.
I don't think you mentioned...
I said none of them is a great prime minister.
You said none. Caller, you said none.
You mentioned, and what you pointed to as being great, quote-unquote, or you had respect for, you had regard for, was the fact that he said nothing on certain bills.
No, caller, you got this very, very wrong. No. You got this very, very wrong. I said that he didn't talk on those bills, and it's significant he didn't talk. And what I was suggesting, he knows those bills were wrong. We had been there. They're not going to produce anything. They might even be illegal and unconstitutional. That's what I was hinting at. I don't think we've ever had any good prime minister. How are you going to judge that? What is a good prime minister?
But Rick, you sounded like you were giving kudos to same talent on things that you knew, like you were
right. Yeah, but there was context. There was context. I was saying to Tim, the fact that I write scathingly about a guy didn't mean he didn't have a good side as well. That's what I was saying there.
I think
yeah,
you got.
I'm taking that away from him, but I'm challenging the point that you sounded.
Anyway, go ahead. Don't worry about me. Go ahead.
I'm talking, Rick. I'm talking. It's not your show tonight. It's Tim's show.
Go ahead, go on.
Rick, you sound. I know I have to chastise you for that because you sound as if you're giving him praise.
Well, now I fix that up.
Kenny Anthony, in his position, he needs not to stay silent on these things. He is best placed to speak out against these things. That's why I do not appreciate.
But I said that.
That you saw it as a good thing.
But I said that. I said he's a constitutional lecturer. Mm. I said you misunderstood totally, caller.
Rick, you sounded like, and maybe how you
sounded like. Let Tim defend me.
Sounded like you were giving him.
Well, that's all right. That's all right. I corrected you.
The next thing you're praising Betty Jean and Christopher Hunt. I mean, Rick, come on. Where's the judgment? Where's the discernment?
Caller, I don't think you're listening to me. You ever heard of a guy called Eldridge Cleaver? Eldridge Cleaver did all kinds of.
You either not communicating properly because I'm not the only person misunderstanding you. I'm reading the comments.
Well, I'm not surprised. I wouldn't be surprised.
You're giving praises and kudos to people for talking the talk about criminality. And I'm just speaking in general. I'm not calling anybody names or saying anything. Speaking about criminality, yeah, you could speak about criminality, but are you still continuing the criminality? You're talking about people speaking about doing tours and reform and so on. Are those people reformed? You know, are those people as actions consistent before when they were in opposition and now they're in government? No, they're not. You're praising people based on lip service when their actions do not back up.
I think I have been.
So, Rick, you always struck me as a guy who is discerning.
I think I have been grossly misunderstood, caller. And I don't normally backtrack. I think you have totally misunderstood me, but I don't
Rick,
mind.
I'm not the only one. So
it doesn't mean that two people can. It doesn't mean two people can't get it wrong, you know. It doesn't mean they can't get it wrong.
It also means you're not communicating.
But even now, I'm telling you what I really said that a bill that was passed in '97, they acted on it. Something like 27 years later, that up to now, that as the caller called, three guys have been paroled. We don't know anything about them except that they were murderers. We don't know. There's no rehabilitation going on. All of that I said as quickly as possible. I think you've totally misunderstood me. This parole program is a joke. Everything.
I wasn't commenting on that.
There's no rehabilitation going on.
Okay, caller, go ahead. One minute. Go ahead, please, caller.
No, I'm done.
That's it?
Thank you.
Okay.
Rick, keep it up.
Thank you very much. That's all right.
All right, thanks a lot. Yeah. We'll take two more calls, and then we'll take final comments from you, Rick. We have another caller line. Good evening to you. Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Yeah, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Yeah, Rick, first to begin, thanks for coming on the show, Timothy. I don't know what trick you pulled on, Rick.
If he was a woman, if he was a woman, you'd say something quickly, right?
Rick, you know, watching you there, you know what the beard did to you?
What?
It made you look like a replica of Denson Dibule.
Of Denson Dibule.
I hope Denson Dibule is not insulted, but it's all right.
No, trust me, that's what you. It make you look so much like him. Rick, you know, in all this, our political situation, you know who comes to my mind, and I would love to hear from him. I think your team should bring him on your show. See, Osbert Dovey.
I'm listening.
I don't know. I have a lot of time for this guy. I don't know.
Well, tell him. I can't ask you why because we don't have time. But I would like to, if you know him well, I would happily have him as a guest on the show. He has his good points.
But why do you want to hear from him?
Tim, I think Osbert is one of the guys in St. Lucia. I think he has a lot to offer. That's how I look at it. That's
But caller, let's not forget without him.
Thank you, caller.
Let's not forget Osbert had ample time to offer.
Yes. And I don't think the Sinisha Labour Party would want to see him get anywhere close to government. We have a final call. Good evening to you. Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Tim, good night. What's up?
I'm okay, caller. Good evening to you.
Good night, Rick. What's up?
What up?
Tim,
mm-hmm.
What is the use of the forensic lab we have in St. Lucia?
The use of the forensic lab?
Uh-huh.
It have different purposes. For example, to carry out various tests on...
We don't have an operational forensic lab.
Okay, Tim. Tim, how many cases have you heard have been solved better than that.
Oh, they have been. They have been, caller. They have been.
Testing of drugs, yes, is one of them.
They have been.
Mm-hmm.
How about the bullets that have been killing people?
I don't know about the ballistics aspect. No.
That's where I want to go. Do that, for instance, have a holding bay for when you have hit and run vehicles that kill people on the road? Do it have that?
But Kola, you know, all the forensic lab and all that kind of stuff, first you have to arrest somebody, get the proper samples and whatever, you know.
And I think the forensic lab has been accredited, eh?
Pardon me?
The lab has been accredited as well.
Yeah, but it's not operational. Yeah. The reason that girl's samples can't get sorted out,
mm-hmm.
or even the lady at the moon and so on, is because of the dysfunctional
state.
Plus, of course, the DPP is a joke. Demonstrably a joke, and so on. You know, we don't have a proper police force. We don't have a proper the justice system is non-existent in name only.
Arthur, final comments from you?
Oh, that's Arthur. That was my pal Arthur.
That's it.
Yeah, man.
All right. Okay. Thanks so much. Final comments from you, Rick.
Well,
I really like to thank you for coming on the program this evening.
I never have final comments. Mm-hmm. I mean, I will go on until I drop. St. Lucia is more appreciated by visitors and people who, like myself, I'm very lucky that I look at St. Lucia both with native eyes and with touristic eyes. And I see the potential of St. Lucia, not just now. My gospel has been the same from Compton days, you know. I haven't changed because there's been no improvement. The country has not changed at all except for the worse. So the subjects are still the same subjects, mm-hmm. you know, the same subjects. So I look at St. Lucia with tourists. I remember the days when I could get in the vehicle. I mean, I have problems walking now, but I could get in the vehicle and go and park and watch the sunset and read it. You think I'd be crazy to do what now?
Yeah.
So what is the point of having an environment like St. Lucia with the sunsets and all the kind of stuff and whatever? And we can't do it. They keep saying, oh, because the white people buy your land. You can't do it because if you go to it, you get shot on rape. That's why. And this it's falsehood that white people come here and just grab land or just give them land. Man, that is just to appease the poorest of the poor, make them feel good. The people come here and they buy land from people who own the land. All these best lands we've had here that hotels are on and all those kind of, belong to St. Lucians, you know. We sold them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, and we have all these guys getting on TV and talking about plantation by the sea. Derek Walker wrote that poem a few years ago. And who you think built the plantations, the slave plantations by the sea? Who built them? Some white man from the Middle Passage. We built them. Our governments get permission to do them. I have always said that it's a shame that we only discovered that we could build hotels like where Bordelais is now, or we can build hotels in Soufre, and we could have kept our beaches clean of hotels. Don't put a single damn hotel there and offer, because there's no place in St. Lucia, especially by taxi, that is further than 10 minutes from the beach. So why do we have all this clogging? And you know another thing? This business about our sole dependence on tourism. Tim, you want the politicians only tell you about the supposed dollars. They don't tell you the millions of gallons of untreated sewer that are going into the waters we drink and bathe in. They don't tell you about those things. Our water supply can barely take care. So many communities in this country don't ever have water because they need water for the tourists and the hotels as well. It's all well and good talking about the tourist dollar. You have to be able to sustain the visitors in a touristic fashion, in the way they're expected to be treated for their money. But the priority has to be the people who live here. But the people who live here, they don't care.
That's why in some countries you have carrying capacity to determine the number of people that you allow.
It's so sad, Tim. And I wish there were more discussion going on in the country about our condition, how much we... I mean, I go back to Hansard some way back to see how far we have regressed, not progressed, regressed.
So I don't have final words. This is it, and I want to tell you very much. I enjoyed this,
and you're looking forward. You will be back on your show next Thursday, not tomorrow, but next week Thursday.
We'll see. I want to thank all those people who welcome. It's always fascinated me my ambivalent relationship with St. Lucia's. You know, they love to hate Rick Wayne.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Rick.
My pleasure.
And as usual, thank you so much for watching the broadcast, and thank you so much for your calls and your discussions in the chat room. If it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that peaked.
Não, não mexe meu celular não. Não mexe meu celular não. Não mexe meu celular não.
Toma aqui essa safadeza.
Once again, here's to a safe and enjoyable evening. Please join me tomorrow afternoon, 12:30 on Power 97.9, as well as on the Newspin Facebook page and YouTube for Newspin. Good night, and see you next time.
I, Philip Joseph here. I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part of a government.
We came into government that we had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party. By the highest body.
We have to take pride on how we've handled
the illegal entry of persons coming in from Martinique, and Martinique remains an area of higher risk for us because
you see all the nice things, all the appealing things, all the emotional things to touch people's heart because you want them to support you and follow you, you inspire them, you give them hope, and they follow you.
But what about the culture of people getting to office and not being effective in terms of
portfolio?
No, but caller, hold on.
Who handled his portfolio?
Hold on, caller, hold on.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmaker Live.